Okay, let's start with that. So what do we mean by creativity when we say that? And why there is a need of creativity? So first we need to understand why there is a need of creativity. So let's say, suppose if I'm like if you're applying for some job, this is all a competitive examination to search for administrators. So what is the requirement when we say that you need to have administrative quality? The very common questions asked and heard very, very often from the students, those who are selected, to yourself, to your friends and all. Teachers say that. But we actually have never explained that. And very often it is not explained properly that what do we mean by administrative quality. Right. Now, look at here. If I'm searching for a clerk, so I would seek the quality in that person, what is required for the best possible job as a clerk. If I'm searching for a typist, right, I would not be interested in his, her look, the dressing pattern, speaking capacity, nothing. I would only be interested in his typing ability. Right. Now, if I'm searching for a counselor, let's say suppose someone who takes care of the front desk, I would not be interested in his or her typing speed. What I would be interested in? Speaking skills. Maybe dressing pattern I would be interested in, the way she or he dresses, the way he or she carries herself or himself. So these are the basic parts. Now, if you look at as an administrator, what is the fundamental requirement? And that's where most of the students come at mistake. The requirement that you may be coming from Tamil Nadu, right, and posted somewhere in a district in Bihar, or maybe Assam or somewhere in northeastern states, right? As an IAS officer, or as an IPS, either DM or SP. Now look at the nature of his or her job. You will understand the requirement. What the examiner would be searching in your answer. As a DM or as an SP, the moment you join at a place far away from your own native place, you don't have any iota of information about that area. You don't know that what kind of criminals exist. You might have read somewhere in the newspaper, but that's not the true story very often. So as an SP, the moment you join, your constable, your DSP, your sub-inspector might be having 100 times more information than you. Right? And you are posted there as an SP, and you are expected to perform rather than your constable, DSP, or your subordinates. You are posted as a DM, and you are expected to perform rather than your subordinates. And here comes the requirement. The moment you join, whatever information you want, you will be provided by your subordinates. The moment you have a meeting with your immediate subordinates, officers, they'll tell you about the whole story of their area. So in my area, these are the basic problems we are facing. Let's say suppose somewhere, some area is caste sensitive, some area is communally sensitive, some area has more problems against women, some areas has small theft and all. So everything, all the information you want, you'll be provided with all the names of the criminals also, those who are involved. They know everything. And yet, when it comes to decision, it is you who are supposed to make. Now you can differentiate the requirement, what the examiner and what actually UPSC wants from you. Not the information. Not the knowledge. Because knowledge is there with your subordinates. So on the basis of that knowledge, your decision-making capacity matters when you become an officer. Right, you read Savinder Singh, you read all the informations, and then you try to vomit that on the surface, on the paper. You are behaving like a clerk. You are behaving like your subordinates, not as an officer, remember it. Right, you might be coming from Harvard University, all the poor urban background, and suddenly you are posted as chairman of the redevelopment board, where you don't have any information about the difference between the cow milk and buffalo milk. And yet you are expected to perform duty or improve what? A department which you don't have much knowledge. Again, the knowledge will be provided to you by your subordinates. And on the basis of that knowledge, you have to make plans. You have to make policies. You have to take decisions for the welfare and the improvement of your department. And that's the crux of the requirement of UPSC. And now, how does UPSC tell you about this? Choose an optional. Selection of optional is the best guideline for its requirement. Irrespective of your background, irrespective of your academic qualification, irrespective of your percentage marks in graduation, master's, whatever, you can have optional, which you don't have any information. You're coming from IIT, you can take Hindi literature, Sanskrit literature, you can take Pali, you can take Urdu literature. UPSC is least bothered about it, remember it. The only exam which perhaps of at least of this nature that you are allowed to write just with 33% marks in your graduation. Even if you go for a lecturer exam, the moment you apply, at least there will be some minimum criteria, 55%. If you go for probationary officers or bank exam, you'll be required with certain percentage, 50%, 55%, somewhere it is 60%. That's what UPSC is different from all the other exams. And that's where its requirement is different from all the other exams. Because the moment you fix a percentage marks, what actually you're trying to tell? That you need knowledge. The people who can hold knowledge. The people who can possess knowledge. The moment you don't have any, you have no criteria as such, means you are indirectly saying that I am least bothered about your knowledge. You have done your master's in IIT. Come, take Hindi literature, show me your administrative capability. Through Hindi literature, through Sanskrit. You maybe have passed Sanskrit from Madrasa University, from any Sanskrit degree college. Just you need to produce a certificate that yes, you are grown up baby, that's it. They're not much bothered about your percentage marks. So all these are suggestive of the fact that the requirement of UPSC is different, remember it. And that's where the actual need is there. That's where the actual information is there. That's where the guidelines, that's the most important guideline. It can be from UPSC side. Look at this here preliminary question. Even those who are preparing since last 5 years, have you ever expected this nature of question in preliminary? That's the beauty of UPSC. You can't predict it. Because you can't predict a situation when you become an IPS. You can't predict a situation when you are working as an IAS. You can't predict a situation when you are working as an IFS as well. So very often at the middle of the night, you will be called by as your subordinates. And there'll be a situation where while brushing your eyes, you have to make decisions. Sir, हमारे यहाँ communal rights हो गया, sir, अचानक हो गया है, कुछ पता नहीं था, idea नहीं था, हम क्या करें? Now they all are disturbed because they can't make decisions. They're looking up to you. Now you can't call. Wait, I'm calling CM and then I'll tell you. No, you have to guide right there. So how do you control your emotions? How do you control your decision-making process? How do you control your that level of blood form movement? That's the nerves, this nerve which is required. Now this year question is not very tough, but the problem is that when you sit in the examination, it was totally unexpected. So your nerves is being checked, remember it. Ultimately, all of the students would have faced the same situation. All of those who are preparing might have the equal amount of information. Now UPSC is challenging you. Answer better than the rest, get through it. How much do you expect cut off this year? It will not be more than 92. 92, 93, it will not be more than that. No, that's the truth. Last year also, if you can go through my recordings also, everybody was saying, sir, not less than 115, 117, 117, 120. I told not more than 15 and 105 to 1010, I told. This year I am telling openly students 98 to 102. But it will come down to 92 to 94. So that's what is being checked. It's not about if the last year you have performed 120. So since you are not performing 120, you get panic in the examination hall and you perform poorer than your capacity. When you perform poorer than your capacity, UPSC is telling to get out. indirectly it is telling you to get out. Because at every time as an officer from our system, you are expected to perform better than your capacity. And this is the challenge in different manners. And this is what UPSC would be looking through your answers. There is a biggest myth that your personality is checked in mains. It is far better checked in. Personality is checked in interview. It's far severely and intensively checked through mains. The moment you write, I can tell you about, even I can tell you about, where the examiner must be at least 20 years more experienced than me. I can tell you that how much, what is your style of sleeping, what are the kind of books you have might have consulted, what is the level of your reasoning. I can tell you through your answer. I haven't seen you. Yet I can tell you how many hours you do your work. I can tell you that also. How many hours roughly do you devote on books? Even that will be there. And that will be checked. Right. So that way, first is the, though very often it students treat it as just as a normal discussion. It's not very important. But the reaching to the root is the primary requirement. And the root is that UPSC is looking for administrators. UPSC is looking for the person who can make decisions, even at the odd situation. And that's where creativity comes. That's where, if you see, that's where the basis of what you should keep on thinking while making an answer, while making points, while introducing something. Right? And from there, we'll start that, how you can make that, develop that feeling and tell the examiner that, look, I have the administrative capability. Right? Now, in geography, I strongly believe, and I can prove with all the other subjects, that it has huge amount of that potential or that information which you can show through your ability to tell the examiner that I have better capability. It's a multifarious subject. Right? You need shallow information. You need correlation. You need integration. And the entire syllabus can be covered with few topics only. With few subjects only. Now, that ability, if you have developed, you don't need informations. At least you don't need much informations. Here, as a clerk, you have to behave. You have to work as a clerk as well. Why? Basically because when you are appointed as an officer, you are provided subordinates. Here, you don't have subordinates. So when you're reading books, when you're finishing your content, remember it, you're just finishing the job of your subordinate. Your actual work begins thereafter. Right? And now how to integrate? Let's see that. And how you can create an answer which will be totally different from others. Let's say you're reading geomorphology. Right? What do you mean by geomorphology? I hope all of you know that. Scientific study of landforms, right? Now, just as a well-educated person, not an academician of geography, the moment you think about landform, what is the image created? Mountains, plains, plateaus, and maybe if you go deeper, some smaller features as well, but broadly it is mountains, plains, plateaus, continents, and oceans. Now, see the landforms, mountains, plateaus, plains. Now, in these three, can you differentiate the possible sectoral aspects of economy? How geography guides the basis of economy of a region. Hopefully, we can easily do that. Plain area mein kis tarah ki economy hogi? Aram sam jaan sakte hain? Kya hoga dominantly? Agriculture. That is primary sector. Plateaus. Generally minerals. Or we can say that not very suitable for agricultural activities. It may have forest and mining. Mining. Now if grown up, maybe transforming into an industrial society. none of these is possible that way. Right? So the economy is different, more based on service sector. Now, can you correlate when you're writing? Let's say suppose if I have a question that discuss the factors responsible for shaping the landforms. Now everybody will start with endogenic forces, exogenic forces, their correlation, how they shape landforms, a lot of example. You are behaving like a geography student. You are behaving like a master's of geography. You are behaving like a PhD in geography. As if you are writing your college exams. No. The moment you give the sense of this, that landform plays a very significant role in determining the socio-economic pattern of a region. Just one line, and your answer is different. Indirectly, you're suggesting to the examiner that, look, sir, I have read, everybody has read, but look, I'm just telling you that I know how to utilize information. That's what you would be looking for. Right? Now, look at here. When sectoral aspect of economy, primary sector, what is the basic traits of this society? All of you know it. The only problem is that we have not developed that thought process. We are not into it. And most of the students fear from using it. Because they have been told, they have been accustomed since their childhood. That's the way they have been doing in their examination. So you are fearful of breaking the traditions. And whereas the fundamental requirement of a leader is, those who do not follow traditions, those who create their own. And you are afraid of doing that. You read a lot of books and then try to jumble it with lots of landforms, good examples from India, and you have lists of examples, and you keep on pumping that. You're basically behaving like a clerk. You're actually telling you that you have good capacity to become a clerk, not an officer. Right. Primary sector, how do you differentiate between primary, secondary, and tertiary sector with respect to their societal evolution, attitude, foundation? Why do North India is more communally sensitive than South India? Why do the women empowerment level is far higher in South India as compared to North India? Any idea? Agar dekhe hum apne yahan, to apne yahan agar pura northern plain ko dekhe. And I can bet on that fact. Because I've roamed around, I've traveled all the way, interacted a lot of the students, and nobody can be better guidelines than people like you. You are the cream of our society. You are the really educated one, not literate, who form hardly 5-7% of the society. And I'm fortunate enough to interact with quality of you all over India. Bangalore, Chennai, Hyderabad, Pune, Jaipur, Ahmedabad, Patna, Guwahati. Now that interaction tells you that what is the difference of mind. And then you can correlate as a student of geography, as in students who seeks to qualify sales services with geography. I would rather say that. North Indians are less religious, more fanatic. And across the religion, I'm telling you. South Indians are more religious, less fanatic. More religious. Far more devoted, far more numbers of temple visitors as compared to North India. But on the road pe jo nanga naach karte hain, you will be missing in South India on the name of religion, and you will be having North India again across the religions. Muslims will behave like that, Hindus will behave like that, Sikhs will behave like that, even Christians of North India will behave like that only. Now, can you correlate that? You can't write that in detail. But can you develop the habit of writing that in a very short aspect and tell the examiner that, look, how much I've thought about it. I have the information. You have, let's say, suppose if you're going through a figure and sex ratio is a very common indicator of a civilization attainment of a society. Like sex ratio, you see that different part of it. Discuss the regional variation in sex ratio in India. Suppose you're writing a question. Present a reasoned account of the variation in the sex ratio, a regional disparity in sex ratio in India. Now everybody will start writing this factor, that factor. But as a geography student, have you gone deeper, which is not there in the book? and you have tried to write. What is the most important reason for poor sex ratio in any area, let's say Punjab, Haryana, and green evolution states, if you say that? Women? So that's the consequence, not the cause. Sorry? So that's South India also. Look at even the most developed country has patriarchal mindset. Exactly. Can you correlate with that? Can you say that a society which is primarily deriving their economy from primary sources will always be inward looking, will always be religious traditions believers, will always be introvert, will not be that tolerant? Look at our western states and eastern states, you will understand that. Look at the history and you will correlate their developmental level and their development level. The moment you see disasters and you can correlate, like eastern states are more prone to the disasters. Coastal state cyclone and floods, plain area floods, all these states which are flood prone area, you see the level of underdevelopment. Can you write that? Which will not be there in the books. But you read this. Like for example, when we say that, let's say women empowerment. So should we believe that the North Indian fathers are cruel and they don't want their daughters to be empowered? South Indians want their daughters to also to be empowered. Right. Now, look at here the difference. Fathers are the same. Mothers are the same. The only difference, they are compelled from their surroundings by their societies, in the society they're living in, not to do that. Right? As a father, nobody is different. As a father, everybody, the moment you love someone, you want her to be the most empowered one. Now, whether how far you are successful is a different issue. But the ultimate feeling will always be same. But you take actions dependent upon the societal perspective, dependent upon the way you perceive the society. So that's where the perceptional environment becomes far, far more important than real environment. The moment you have an image, let's say suppose a state like Bihar, what exactly you feel? Poverty, rickshaw puller, right? A labor class going to running to Mumbai, Delhi and Kolkata and all. Right? The moment you have image in Bihar, you think that the moment you go to that place, you will be picked, beaten. That's the general impression. Most of our students don't prefer to give Bihar as choice of their cadre. That's the mental image you are carrying. And how that image affects the overall socioeconomic condition of that area, you can correlate. That's perceptional environment. You have two types of environment. Real environment and perceptional environment. That's for part B and all. When you write, you generally write with respect to real environment, whereas you are supposed to write with respect to perceptual environment. Now, Bihar, I can tell you the moment you go, especially present-day Bihar, right, is far, far better than many states as far as socioeconomic aspect is concerned. You have more number of IAS officers, IPS officers coming from that state, but you still believe that only rickshaw pullers comes from that state. You have more number of civilized people who are speaking at different forums in India and maybe over the world also, coming from that area, yet you see that Bihar is the people from that area is uncivilized. If you have not interacted with the people, and that's where the role of interaction. When you interact, that image breaks. And if you have flexibility, you will break that image. And when you break that image, you grow up. When you grow up, your productivity will increase. That's what interaction play a very important role, which we very often come across, realize, have experienced in our life, yet afraid of writing the same in the examination. When you write about tourism, let's say any question about tourism, whether it is ecotourism, general tourism, the developmental aspect, tourism industry, start with that. Now everybody will write the economic perspective, write the cultural aspect. Especially in a diverse country like ours, tourism play a very, very significant role in diffusing that or breaking that image, structured opinion, which is so vital for the integration of a nation like us. Now you start with this, and you see the change in marks. And if you write tourism is this, local tourism, international tourism, everybody will write that. So that is your presenting information. And that's where we call it creativity. That's where we say that, yes, you have administrative quality. And that's where we can say that, yes, I have written a better answer. Any of the answers, if you see those who have scored very high marks, you read it, you'll be surprised that not a single information you can say that I don't possess if you have finished your option. Not a single information. The only thing that there will be simplicity. There will be this kind of creativity. Let's say suppose if you are writing about desert, let's say, discuss the geomorphological features of Thar desert. Anybody who has the information of it? Do you know this answer, the answer of this question? Especially the body parts. If this question comes in the mains examination, can you write it? If I tell you to write it right now, can you write it? Okay. Oasis likh sakte hain. Likh sakte hain. We don't need information. But very often you will make an image, oh my God, I have not read about the Thar desert. When they are saying about, discuss the geomorphology of Thar desert, it is indirectly saying you, please explain a little bit of the desert landforms. That's it. And all of us know that. Sand dunes, we know. We know the playa lakes. We know the deflation, activities of wind. Bolsan, Bajda, playa, sab pade hue aap. Right? I know you can write that. But you, since you have the image that I haven't read it, because Thar ke bare mein specially to nahi padha hai, and under the pressure of the examination hall, you may not be able to write it. Now, how to make it creative? Deserts are the areas of harsh climate, poor biodiversity, low density of population, challenging climatic conditions for the human society. Yet, it can be developed with the good amount of, reasonable amount of investment on the development of tourism like Dubai. Come to Thar Desert then, thereafter. And if you see the purity of deserts, Thar Desert is 10 times better than Dubai. Right? And look at Dubai, how it is developed. Despite being a complete desert area, perhaps the only country which doesn't have any oil then in that area. And yet it is one of the most developed countries in that area. The whole West Asia. So socially also, one of the most developed, one of the most liberal society in is Dubai as compared to Earth. Can you correlate? West Asia is, you know, how orthodox, how conservative. What is the primary reason for that? And please feel free to speak. So how challenging geographical condition makes it conservative? Okay, let me correlate, let me compare. The social condition, socio even economic condition of West Asia is very much similar to our green revolution states. So what makes Punjab reflecting similarity on social indicators with that of West Asia? What makes Haryana reflect similarity of social indicators with West Asia? What makes Western UP reflecting the similarity of social indicators with West Asia? Perfectly similar. Exactly. And now can you correlate that? They also derive their economy from crude oil, primary sector. We in green revolution states, primary sector, and primary sector slightly developed level, like semi-commercialized agriculture we have in green revolution states. You can correlate. And you can say that all the areas which derive their economy mainly from primary sector are relatively conservative, and you can give examples. Right, very often we get confused with religion, the impact of religion. Now, that's a child hawa discussion. That can't be a thought of a would-be IAS officers. That can't be a thought of a multidimensional personality who are supposed to read polity, economy, geography, history, science and technology, social issues, international issues, current affairs, so many happenings. That means you are just a bookish worm. If you just correlate with some immediate image which has been created in your mind, and if you write that, examiner is not a politician, remember it. They are intellectuals, and they'll see you through intellectually. Right? Now, look at the best example in our country is Punjab is dominated by Sikhs, Haryana is dominated by Hindus, and Western UP is dominantly populated by Muslims. And all these three, despite the three different religions, the three topmost religions of the world, they will reflect a similar social characteristics. Long ghungat, somewhere you have burqa, somewhere you have full salwar sameez with dupatta. Now, what makes West Asia different from our Green Revolution state, despite some certain level of similarity in their social characteristics, is the fact that they are governed by a larger country, which are more tolerant, which is more broad, which is more dynamic in its approach because of its constitutional obligations. Yet you have Khap Panchayat in our country in 21st century. Right? Will you correlate that with religion? No. Right? Now, you see the simplicity of that. You pick up something which is very easy to pick. But that's not your job. That's not the job of the intellectuals. That's the job of the politicians, the religious leaders. Leave them alone. You behave like what you are. Now you can correlate the moment you read that, and if you have not deciphered it, you are studying poorly. Right? So when it is about something, can you integrate a lot of things? Have you ever seen heavy metallic minerals in the plain area? Have you ever seen heavy metallic minerals or mines found in a plain area? No? Now, books will not teach you that. When you read the distribution of minerals, like resources distribution, very often one of the toughest topics for geography students to prepare, and trust me, it is the easiest to prepare. Water resources, forest resources, all are reflection of geomorphology and climatology. If these two areas of yours are very good, 90% of geography is finished. 90%, I'm saying, geography is finished. And very good doesn't mean that you have crammed up all the information from Savinder Singh or from Stoller, whatever source you have. When I say very good, only mean that with the knowledge, can you correlate? Two things fundamental, geomorphology and climatology. Soil types, forest resources, water resources, mineral resources. Most of the resources can be finished from here itself. You can not only reduce your workload, but also have learned a lot of integration capacity. Plain areas, why it is not found, heavy metallic minerals are not found, or mines will not be very popular. That will never be popular for minerals. That will be popular for agriculture. The moment you go through the regional distribution of minerals in India, you'll find that Chotanagpur Plateau, Bastar Plateau, Karnataka Plateau, Bundelkhand, four major mineral regions of our country. Now, as a student of geography, you should be able to correlate that. Why? Why? Only because of one factor, they are Precambrian structure. And all the Precambrian structures are denuded. And denuded and exposed. When the bottom of a topography is exposed, it will always have heavy metallic minerals. Right? Now, when you write denudation, please convey this message to the examiner. Denudation plays a vital role in determining the resource base of a region. Can you correlate? It's a challenge. This is a challenge for you. Learning geography is, I think, the easiest thing for the people like you. Is the easiest thing. Scoring marks is actually a challenge. Why scoring marks is a challenge? Basically because they are searching differently. They'll be looking different things from you. Their perspective, their opinion, their basis of you judging will be different. unlike academician, unlike a research scholar. And that's where you have to perform. That's where you have to reflect. Plain areas, agreed, emanated. Now suppose, if you have a question that suggest a model for the development of Uttar Pradesh. You can't write iron and steel industry. Right? Now reflect that. Why can't you write can also be the introductory part. Why can't you write one, why can't you suggest iron and steel industry, copper smelting stainless industry, or even refineries like Mathura is not going to solve the problem of UP. Why? If you want to have a growth pole, have a growth pole on the basis of the resource base of that area. Right? When you are writing growth pole, can you reflect this image? Can you bring that feeling of yours about geography into your answer? When you are writing answer over settlements, let's suppose. Right? Discuss the system and pattern of rural settlements in India with examples. Now, everybody start by writing settlement pattern, system, different types of pattern, and these type of patterns are forming these type of landforms. Can you go beyond that? Can you go beyond that and start with the fact that settlement of an area is a reflection of the socio-economic development, civilizational attainment, and various facets of culture, reflection of various facets of culture. Isn't it? When you see the settlement, without actually interacting with the humans, can't you write about an essay about that? So any question on settlement, begin with that. Can you begin with that feeling, that reflection? Urban area, suppose. Smart city, if you're writing. So everybody will write that. Remember, it's a competition. Remember, you have to forcefully tell the examiner that, look, sir, I have better administrative capability. And administrative capability, I hope you have understood. What is that? So when you are writing about urbanization, talk. Start with the fact that urban areas are the most important center of what? Everybody will write economic activity. Can you go beyond that? Cultural integration, cultural interaction, diffusion of innovation. Right? People coming from, let's say, suppose all the way from rural areas of Uttar Pradesh visiting Delhi. They're staying for 2 days or a day just for some work. They're looking at the women of that area. Their standard, male-female interaction, education standard. When they go back, my God. Now look at it, diffusion of innovation. Definitely, they have carried some image of urban areas. Right? Some may feel bad that girls are sitting in the parks with the boys. Right? Now, they'll start discussion. Should it be there or not? That's fine. Let them start. Discourse is the beginning of the improvement. Even if it has started with the worst topic, remember it, ultimately it has a better result. So, diffusion of innovation. And so vital for a vast country with huge amount of regional and intra-regional disparity like us. Now look at how many topics you have correlated in two lines of introduction. And that's what administrative capability. And that's what they will be looking for. Everything you see in geography has a lot of integration. Why do iron and steel industries in our country has its specific locations? Why it couldn't spread pre-90s? Why it has started spreading post-90s? Now, discuss the locational factor of iron and steel industry in India. Now, everybody will write the factors which has been crammed up, which has been told to them. Now, what is yours? How you are different from your competitors? How you are saying that, look, I have the capacity to become an IAS officer or a postal service officer? Or to out of the list? This is the way you can tell. The resource base. Now you can bring some landforms. Because ultimately you are writing questions, answers over geography. So you can always use basis of geography while elaborating or while linking your topics. Why do our crude oil, our refinery industry is located along the coastal areas? Let's say about this question itself. Discuss the factors of location of refineries in India with suitable example. Close to the? No. Rare is market location. Most of them are raw material based location. Most of our crude oil is imported. Right? Can you bring Weberian concept in the beginning itself? Can you talk about material index here? Now, can you talk about the role of refinery in overall economic setup and integration? Can you talk about refineries as a source of energy security? Like several students can have several direction. In your own direction, through your own thought process, never buy from someone else. Remember it. Through your own. One question can have at least 10 different directions of thought. Can you correlate that? Refineries like weight losing industry, the material index, and according to the Weberian concept, most of the weight losing industries are supposed to be located in an account, in and around the raw material source. And the weight gaining should be in the marketplace area. We have a mixed bag of both. Almost all of our refineries are raw material based. Look at a whole lot of western states, Mumbai High, Gujarat, Koyalis and all, and then imported. We import from west side. So the closest location from the raw material source is western coast. And you see the number of refineries along the western coast. Digboi, Narkotia, Moran, all these are in the oil producing areas. Brownie, Mathura, Panipat, all these are market based. Now, market based, but with the plan of the growth pool concept. In accordance with the growth of polar concept, yet it couldn't be successful. It didn't produce the desired result. Now you can correlate. Why? Because that resource base was not perfect. The selection of industry or the growth pole was not perfect with respect to the socio-economic conditions of that area or geographical conditions of that area. That's why Mathura refinery could not produce that much result. You can always say that. You can always correlate that. So in every area, if you see, like for example, if you're writing about, let's say, suppose the second part, very often, that's the most creative part you can, highest level of creativity you can generate. If you're writing, let's say, suppose system analysis. If you're picking up information and example from book, you're writing about the system, links, this is the types of links, these many types, example is, no, there's not going to give you marks. Correlated, like for example, that book writes, it's a very famous book on urban settlement. I'm forgetting the name of the writer. Problem hai na ki aap log coaching institute ke notes se taiyari karte ho, wahan pe bhi ek problem hoti hai. Problem hai ki aap model answer dhoondte ho. Aur yahi wajah hai ki Shamim Anwer jaise teacher popular nahi ho pate, kyunki main model answer nahi deta. Main model har ek ko banana chahta hu. Har banda apne aap mein ek model answer hai. Guts hai aapko andar utna khodne ka apne ko, aap model answer generate kar sakte ho. Provided hai ki hum utna pain nahi lena chahte. The problem is that hum utna pain nahi lena chahte. Hum chahte hain halke mein koi cheez ho jaye. Nahi hogi. Ho bhi jayegi, so that is not your potential. Remember it. Ho sakta hai, with all small things you have qualified, that means you have much bigger potential. Maybe you were supposed to be the topper, but you ended up in 500 rank or 200 rank. Right? So take that much pain. And in fact, that's fun. It's not pain. That's the fun of preparation. But we have been doing in this direction. Ghode ke lagam ki tarah laga hua hai. Tum log waise hi jayenge. We are afraid of taking risks. We are afraid of changing the direction despite the fact that last three attempts have produced the same marks. And complain karenge geography mein number nahi aate. Bahut common complaint aata hai ye bachchon ke taraf se ki geography optional ne duba diya. Nahi bachche, aapko dusra optional bhi duba deta. दूसरा ऑप्शनल चेंज करते हो सकता है कि आप क्वालिफाई कर जाते, इसलिए कर जाते कि वो नया सब्जेक्ट था, पूरी आपने नयापन दिखाया आपने, उसमें नॉलेज आपको नहीं होगा. एंड यू डिडंट रिलाई ऑन द नॉलेज, रादर ऑन द स्मॉल अमाउंट ऑफ नॉलेज यू वेंट रोट द आंसर्स. दैट मीन्स यू हैव मोच मोर इनपुट फ्रॉम योर क्रिएटिविटी. यू क्रिएटेड द आंसर्स ऑन द बेसिस ऑफ स्मॉल इन्फॉर्मेशन. बी रेडी टू डू द सेम. Try to unlearn something. Try to reduce your base knowledge. Very often the people will say that increase your base knowledge. Most often I say that reduce your base knowledge and then complete the answer. Very tough to do that. Very tough to lose out some of the information you already have in the answer. And that's where we commit mistakes. We fill these jargons. We decorate our answers with good quality English. They will never reward you. They're not searching for these stage speaker or the debater. You will come across and you will realize with your friends very often that those who cannot write one line proper, grammatically correct English have scored 175 out of 200 in essay. Because they're not searching for people who can write English and who can write so beautifully. When we say that your writing style is not about the word, it's not about the language. Obviously, language not, if it is good, it's great. But don't emphasize too much over decorated English. Don't emphasize too much over jargons. Language plays only a role in conveying the message of your administrative capability. Remember it. Because if you are a Bihari and you are posted as an IPS in Tamil Nadu, language doesn't play any role. You don't know their language and your people will not know your language. If you speak in English, 90% of Tamil may not understand at all. And 90% of Tamil do not understand Hindi. Now you have to communicate with your own citizens in a language which you don't know how to communicate. So language is not tested. Only thing which is tested is your ability to use information, remember it. And only thing which you are supposed to reflect is your ability to use information, that's it. Nothing else. Same goes with mapping. I have seen boys and girls getting obsessed with the number of maps. Trust me, I'll cut it down. I'm not saying don't use maps, but I discourage map because I've seen students obsessed with that. Don't do that. Map is not geography and geography is not maps. And when we, especially with respect to civil service writing, it's not writing. Those who are research scholars, they will suggest you that write lot of maps. I'm very bad, suppose, in map making. Why the hell I should use map? Because that will not create an impression, in fact, that will degrade my impression, that will diminish my impression. So why should I use something which is going to diminish my impression? So I'll use some of the small maps which I can draw properly. That's it. And you have a right example in front of you, that Pratham Kaushik. You see the maps he has picked up. Very simple, very small. You can see it, that in NCRT. Right? Very often, students, I have seen that one answer, five maps must be there, six maps must be there. No, don't write even a single map with that intention. Don't draw even a single map with that intention that I have to give it. No, if question demands it, if you think that drawing this map will enrich the answer, will elaborate some points which I am not able to write, which I don't want to write, do it. Give it, maybe 10, don't mind. But only when the content requires. Because if you put the patches, examiners do understand that you have been guided by someone. You have not applied your mind. And when you have not applied your mind, they will not prefer to take you, remember. They will never prefer to take you. Yes, you should hear everyone. You should listen to everyone. You should go through every book. Apply your mind. Information will be provided to you by your subordinates. But even there, you are expected to apply your mind to take decisions, not someone else. Draw maps if it is required. Don't draw maps if it is not required. Right? And if you are good in drawing maps, write lot of maps. Doesn't matter. But if you are very bad, try to do the least. Avoid it. Unless it is absolutely necessary. And you know that how to draw it. A rough drawing. It's fine. Never have any kind of preconceived notion. Presumptions. That's where UPSC will hit you the most. And as you see the examination patterns, see the nature of questions every year. In one plate tectonic, they have made at least 100 questions. Which you may not have even a glimpse of it. The questions will be made in such a manner. So understand that basic requirement. Why you are writing geography? Is it to get selected as a researcher scholar under someone who is great? Or is it a would-be IAS officer? If it is would-be IAS officer, the requirement is totally different. If it is a research scholar exam, academic exam of geography, the requirement is totally different. And that is where we have to understand the fundamental requirement, and we should try to bring the most of it into your writing. And that's what we call it creativity. Nothing else. Creativity does not necessarily mean you need to have two wings and two horns and then try to bring that and then dig it out, then calligraphy. No. Creativity simply means that the way you want to utilize your information. It should be different. At least at the end of the answer, you can say that this particular statement is purely mine. Nobody would have written it. Generate that one feeling. For even one statement, that's more than sufficient. But if you have not generated that feeling, and if you're feeling that, oh, I have drawn everything which is written for a settlement in that, let's say, suppose, some other books. Maybe climatology, I've written D.S. Lal ka entire topic, humne likh diya, cyclone ke baare mein. Zabardast likha. Nahin. Wo zabardast aapka college ke liye. Wo zabardast aapka UPSC ke liye. Nahin hai. And integration. In, let's say, suppose if you're writing perspective in geography, can you bring something of geomorphology into it? We have written that earth, man is a product of earth. So there are several statements of the scholars. What do you mean by that? They are correlating. If you see, the whole lot of determinism philosophy is based on the two concepts, the two effects. Effects of geomorphology and climatology. Can you write that? Like this question, this statement, so like for example, E.C. Semple states that the people of mountainous region are cunning. Introvert. The people of plain area are cunning. Can you elaborate that? The moment you see that statement, can you elaborate from your own experience? We are fortunate to be born in a country where you don't need to go and look for examples in another country. We have all. And fortunately, the people like you have interacted with lots of people. From, let's say, suppose Kanyakumari to Kashmir, at least a little bit of interaction directly or indirectly, you do have. Can you frame your answer? Can you elaborate that statement by correlating geography, its impact on economy, and geography and economy together impacting the society? Why the people of tropical region are more reactive? Why the people are like, let's say China? What is the difference between China and US? If you see their attitude, you can correlate it through geography. China is also a power. It's becoming a power. USA has already used that status. USA has been worse as far as international community is concerned, as far as imposition of its own will is concerned over international community. But they have never been getting a bad name. But China will be, if you write about the power, China is a violent state. Because tropical country people do have that reactive tendency. And look at why? Extremes of climate. And extremes of climate, like wherever the winter and summer is extreme, the people will have reactive tendencies. Wherever, look at the mountainous people, they will be really docile. They will be really self-confident. Introvert. They will not be that extrovert like plain people. Because they are used to, because of settlement. Now can you correlate with the settlement? How do scattered settlements play an important role in shaping the mind of the people? Now, let's say suppose in mountainous region, what is the nature of the settlement? not semi-compact even, generally scattered. I'm not talking about the place like Shimla or Srinagar. But historically, one settlement, another settlement, third settlement. Now, settlements are so scattered that you can't actually expect any help in case of emergency from your neighbors. Let's say as a small child, you are sitting in your room and suddenly you saw a snake, or let's say leopard. You will not expect someone else to come and help you, because that person or the family will be far away from you. So by the time they reach and help you, things might have been finished. So you develop that ability to fight it out alone, or maybe with your siblings. So you become introvert. You become self-dependent. Look at how geography affecting the settlement and how settlement affecting the attitude. In the plain area, it's a very compact settlement. In the compact settlement, the people live very nearby. So the moment you saw a fire, there's a smoke going on. So there will be echoing of sound like a Saas Bahu ka serial, this thing. Aag lagi, aag lagi, aag lagi, aag lagi. Well, it will spread like this. People will run to help, and only to find out that there was havan going on. There's nothing fire. So can you ride that? Can you have that feeling? Can you correlate the cultural aspect? Look at the dressing pattern of Rajasthan and dressing pattern of West Asia. Perfectly similar. Look at the pagadi in Rajasthani areas. Look at the loose clothes even for the male in Rajasthan. Loose clothes for female in the Rajasthan. Long ghugant in Rajasthan. The only difference or only impact of say religion or region. I would call it region rather than religion. That they wear burqa and these ladies wear long ghugants. Because women are supposed to protect their beauty. Right. So dust particles and all, which is a common phenomenon in desert area or semi-arid areas. Look at the dressing pattern, how it is affected by the landform itself. Can you write and give examples? No book will teach you. Because the books don't have that much space to write it. And they are not meant for civil servants. They are basically meant for academicians who are least bothered about. Because they understand their interrelationship of geography and all is altogether a different matter of debate, which requires high level of intellectualism. Reading books and then writing about desert and all, basically you're behaving like a college going student. You're behaving like a research scholar. Hundreds of such examples you can have. Always give one common example of effect of temperature on dance pattern. If you see European dance, the most famous dance and all the temperate region and the relatively low temperature region, hip dance, belly dance. Belly means tummy will move like this. Hip means buttocks will move like this. So one part of body will have a close move, like finger dance. That's there. Eye dance you have in Europe. Like the eyelashes women make longer and then they dance it like this. You can have seen this, like this, several dance. Look at African dance. One arm is here, another arm is here, one leg is there, a second leg will be there. They'll be jumping. Can you correlate with geography? Just simply recall your sleeping style in winter and sleeping style in summer, and you can correlate. Look at how much effect we have. Now, if I frame a question, that determinism, the philosophy as a philosophy has not lost its relevance. In fact, it needs a further research elaborate. Very best good example is global warming, especially anthropogenic induced global warming. Can you give such examples? You have a lot of such examples. Now you can dig out where books have not taught, and you will have edge over your competitors. Rather than writing about what Russell says, what Eratosthenes has suggested, why Herodotus has suggested. No, everybody will write, man. That's a job of a clerk. And very often you may not be able to remember all the names also. And you will be breaking your head right there in the examination hall where you needed to be cool, calm and composed in recalling the name. Give these examples. West Asia is altogether a different place in a different region. Our Rajasthan, parts of Haryana and Punjab is different, and you see the similarity between their social behavior, their attitude foundation, their dressing pattern. So much similar. Empowerment of women. They are also least empowered. These guys are also least empowered. Governed by totally two different constitutions. They are governed by dictators. We are a democratic country. Look at how much economy has a common influence. And how economy is primarily determined by the geographical conditions of the area. Look at in the equatorial region. What is the climatic condition? High rainfall, high humidity. Right. Discuss the general characteristics of equatorial climate, suppose. And if you start writing that, now you see, just you tell me, why should I give you marks? Because that can be written by 8th class students who have read that. Most of the informations you are providing. So can you tell me that you know the informations and you know, don't only, not only know, have the informations, but also have the ability to utilize that. How? High humidity, high temperature is so conducive for microorganism. In our country, you can see rainy season. Lots of insects and microorganisms will be there in the atmosphere, in your immediate surrounding, in houses and all. In the winter season, you don't have. You have the least. In extreme summer also, you have the least. So now reflect that. That's the reflection of the fact that that's the most perfect and with the perfect climatic condition for the microorganisms to grow. Isn't it? Now, microorganisms presence in an area, how it would have its impact over the society. Disease will be prevalent. Mortality rate will be high. Death rate will be high. Whenever death rate is higher, birth rate will also be. Whenever birth rate and death rate is both high, life expectancy will be lower. Now everybody will, like those who have thought deeper will reach till here. Go beyond this. When the life expectancy is lower, entrepreneurship development is lower. Actually, you are not having enough incentive. At the age of 40, still I am trying to work harder so that my 70s and 80s can become better. Because I may die next year, that doesn't matter. But expectation is that I might live 70, 75 years. Right? So I'll have to plan for that 35 years. So I'll be working, let's just imagine that if our life expectancy in our country is 40 years, would you actually be effectively be sitting in this classroom? No, why should I waste here? Those next 15 years somehow I will have to. Now here you're not only thinking about civil services and the 60 years, but post-retirement I might get a post of governor also. So when the life expectancy is lower, entrepreneurship development, lower, productivity, lower, productivity is lower, income is lower, saving is lower, investment is lower, productivity is lower. Vicious cycle of economy. Now, when you are writing about the fact that discuss the reasons for the underdevelopment of resource-rich region, that's for the UPSC question, underdevelopment of resource-rich region of West Africa and West Asia, nobody, I can bet, will write these parts. They'll start with civil war. Civil war is a consequence, not a cause. Cause is different. They'll start about the absence of democratic form of government, dictatorship. Dictatorship is a cause, not a effect. Saudi Arabia is dictators, is a cause, not an effect. Iran has got transformed from a very well democratic society into a dictator, is an effect, not a cause. Because a single ruler, a dictator, is easier to handle by the world powers as compared to democratically elected leaders. Suppose if Modi ji takes decision which is not in the interest of the country, we'll throw him out next year. Right? So it will not be in the interest of, let's say, America, who wants to exploit oil from our country, suppose. So if a person, single person is there, dictator is there, it is very much in the interest of the world powers. Because that can be easily handled. So that's where you see dictatorship. The champions of democracy, America, which attacks different country, because they are not a democratic country, the best ally is the most dictator. Saudi Arabia is the biggest dictator of the world. And that's the closest ally of US. Why? Because the dictatorship in that region suits the geopolitical condition of that area. I will say that dictator country, democracy nahi hai. Civil wars. A civil war is basically being created so that the area remains disturbed and people don't think about too much of rights and resources. So you look at Africa is engaged in civil wars, not because of the fact that people are fighter. Africans have never been fighter. People of tropical region has never been fighter. Look at in our country. Very often we correlate with China, with compare ourselves with China. We should never be compared with China. We should never ever have been compared with China. Because the philosophy, the fundamental philosophy of the society is different. We as a nation is more philosophical. We as a nation is more spiritualistic. China as a nation is more materialistic. हमने चार गुजराती पैदा कर दिए हैं, वो पूरा इंडिया चला रहा है, बहुत अच्छी बात है. बाकी पांच में कुछ करने की जरूरत ही नहीं है. We don't need in fact. Because we are not, as a society, we are not that. We are not materialistic. We have never been materialistic. It is not in our blood. Now, can you write that? Obviously, we can't write though in a very abstract manner. But you can write the essence diplomatically, beautifully, intelligently. You can use those informations while writing about temperature. Let's say, suppose there will be several times, discuss the pressure zones of the pressure belts of the earth. Discuss the temperature belts of the earth. Now, 8th class geography student might have the answer. Why UPSC is asking so simple question? Discuss the temperature inversion, causes and consequences of temperature inversion. The moment you start geography, you go through climatology, the first, second, third topic you have is temperature inversion. So UPSC knows that every student must be knowing this answer. Right? And yet it is asking regularly on those questions. Understand that requirement. Understand that information doesn't matter. Even in temperature inversion, the examiner is 100% sure that everybody has the information. Yet he or she is giving that question to test your that ability. Like for example, if I ask a very tough question to you, and if you could not generate some creativity, I might forget it. Might not punish you. But for a question which you might have read 100 times, and yet you are not being creative, that means your ability will be questioned, remember it. And that's where we have to learn. That's where we have to actually be focusing on that, how to integrate ideas, how to correlate geography. Like I was talking about this aspect, landform can be correlated with resource distribution. Right? Resource distribution can be correlated with industrial location. Landforms together with climate can be correlated with the water resources. If the, let's say suppose, Y2 we have, let's say suppose, present a recent account of the distribution of irrigation system in our country. Now, as a geography student, as a student geography in college, you will write that this area because of this. First, you start with the landform. Look at a whole lot of peninsular plateau and mountainous region. Now, when you say that rainfall is less, that's why people area is deficient in rain, deficient in water resources. No. In the mountainous region where the rainfall is very high, yet people face water crisis. Why? Rajasthan has less water crisis as compared to many of the highest rainfall receiving region of Meghalaya. Why? Because drainage system is not sufficient enough to store water naturally. And then it depends upon the role of the human, the paneling management. Then you can talk about water harvesting, watershed management. But when you start, you have to start with that rock types, nature of rainfall, and the drainage system play a significant role in the distribution of water resources. Crystalline rocks, seepage is less. Now, problem is that, are you ready to be flexible enough in your preparation period to integrate that? These are not big things, but very tough to adopt, remember it. Very, very tough. You have to get involved into it almost on daily basis. And believe me, you will get tremendous change in your marks on general studies as well. The writing pattern of general studies is also the same. Requirement is perfectly same. The only difference is that optional, you have greater chance of creativity because the nature of the question will be such. For example, like where the, actually this is in the introductory part and concluding remarks, right? Very often you might be questioning to yourself, and there might be several people who will question you that why there is a need of interaction in 150 word, right? I would simply say that as a very simple example is, what's your name? Guru Kirat. Introduce yourself. Can you differentiate the requirement of the question? What is your name? Guru Kirat, finished. You don't have any scope to say if and but and history of your naming. And you maybe your father wanted something, your mother wanted something. But since your grandmother has a greater role to play, my name is Guru Kirat. So this is beating around the bush. What is your name? Guru Kirat, finish. Introduce yourself. You can't stop just by saying your name, just like you elaborate. Right? So the same way when the question demands, like for example, what are the limitations of continental drift theory? Suppose the question says that, which used to be earlier. Start with following are the limitations of the continental drift theory. Because question states that. That's what you're showing your discipline. In the next answer, you show your creativity. But here it is not demanded. So don't unnecessarily try to jump the gun. What are the limitations of continental drift theory? Following are the limitations of continental drift theory. The continental drift theory presented by Wegener has a lot of limitations. Discuss. Totally different requirement. Continental drift theory has formed the base for the most dynamic theory of plate tectonics. Now you have a lot of creativity. Scope, in fact, if you are writing that following are the limitations of, that will be a wrong answer in the second question. And that will be a perfect beginning in the first question. So you need to be smart enough where to give, where not to give. And it's not necessary that every question needs some introduction. But wherever it is, overall, holistically tell the examiner that, look, wherever you asked my name, I just told you my name. If you told me to introduce yourself, I had a better introduction of mine. I told you about my habits, my past, my present, and all. And in the concluding remarks, always think about the future of the topic and the way you want to see the topic in the future. Right, that's the crux of the conclusion. Body parts, just write like a child the topic you know. Not like a would-be IAS officer in our imagination. Right, very often we feel that stars are produced and those stars would be twinkling directly in the mind of the would-be IAS officer. And that hitting and then creating a different mind who become an IAS officer. And we create an image totally different of what is the reality. The reality is that they're just like you. Many of the qualified students are worse than you, yet they have qualified in many ways. Right? So think rationally and take it just like any other question. Try to be creative in the concluding remarks, the way you want to see the topic in future. Let's say, suppose, if you are writing about earthquakes, discuss the causes and consequences of earthquakes. Suppose that as simple as that a question. Now, in the introductory line, start with the fact that earthquake has played a vital role in delineating the tectonic boundaries. Its waves has enabled us to learn about the interior of the earth, which is so vital for the understanding of geography. If you see the most authentic source of information of the interior of the earth, it is seismology, right? Talk about that. Then you talk about the causes. These are the causes: tectonic earthquake, Fulan earthquake, Deccan earthquake. Then, right? Then conclusion. What actually would like to introduce in the topic? Anybody? What actually you would like to have the status of the topic in the future. That's the beginning. That's the introductory part. Prediction of timing. Right. There should be a lot of research work. Though a lot has been done, you can talk about the, if you had have read that a lot of research is going on the San Andreas fault. And they are almost about to predict the timing of the earthquake. But successful prediction of earthquake, especially with respect to timing, don't degrade. Never end with a negative note. Never ever end with a negative note. There are few things you need to take care of. All, most of you have already written and at least mature enough, must have heard a lot of things. I'm simply saying that don't end with negative note. End always with some change, positive change in the topic. Start the conclusion with a trend of the fact that the situation is not very good. Yet with my suggestion, the situation can be good. The feeling should be in the conclusion is this. And this is what I want in the future about the topic. Right? Smart city. So obviously the role of urban areas in the socio-economic and cultural integration of a nation. These three topics you can write in your own way. You can dig out this statement in your own way. Then while concluding remarks, obviously, that the situation must be controlled because it's very often going to out of control, especially in terms of congestion, pollution, the traffic speed and all. So this should be done, finished. So in the future, you are saying that city should also be a place worth living for almost all sections of the society. So that way, if you see, the geography has huge amount of scope. You pick up any topic, it has some relation with every topic. The problem in our preparation process is that we always prepare individually. Right? Let's say, suppose the geomorphology or the morphology of this river appears very tough question, but for Indian it should not be very tough question. The problem is that we read from the books, we try to understand through the writings of the writer. You all have your own experience of jumping in the rivers, right? Read what is morphology, right? And then try to find out what can be the chronological changes in it. What would have been in the past? Like present is the key to the past. Then correlate with that, can you bring the theory of uniformitarianism also into it? And can you tell that is my, indirectly, that's my personal experience. We have been living by the side of a river. And we can easily write the morphology without actually going to the content of the books. Just let me know the technical term only. What do you mean by river valley? What do you mean by river bed? What is cross section? What is this, like different type of sections? So the term you should be aware of. And give me those topics. Give me those key terms which I may not be aware of, which I'm not supposed to be aware of, without actually going through geography content, I can write the answer. That ability should be there. And that's where you can score. Any of the question, if you wish, please let me know. नहीं ज़्यादातर क्या होता है कि वैसे questions को आप छोड़ दीजिए अगर बिल्कुल ही idea नहीं है. If you can somehow, let's say, decipher the term, right? जैसे पिछले बार ये था जैसे pseudo volcanism, ठीक है? तो you know volcanism, you know word pseudo. So if you can reach out to the real meaning of the term, you should be able to, you should try it. Like time geography, either you know it or you don't know it. Don't write. Remember it, it's not about writing 250 marks. It's about scoring high, right? In the given circumstances. I can tell you the name of one guy. I always miss him in the selection list. But unfortunately, he doesn't complete his paper. He left 40 marks in paper 2. That means he attempted 210 marks. He scored 147. Right? So it's not, it's definitely about the completion of paper, but not just for the sake of it. Don't ruin your impression in the beginning itself. That kya aap hat wale hain. No, when you are first, you can use any. That's not the quality of the administrator. If you have some idea, examiner will give you leverage that fine, you have some idea and you attempted it. If you don't have any idea, like the topic is determinism and you are writing about the volcanism. This shouldn't be there. Otherwise, if you can somehow decode the term, like pseudo-volcanism could have been written by anyone. Right? But time geography, not. Because this has been picked up from a specific book. Thornbury se usne utha liya. So if you are aware, fine. If you are not aware, fine. Leave 15 marks. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. You can attempt 235 marks and you can score 150. And remember, it's always a competition. If one thing is poorer, it is for all. It's tougher or for all. And you will not be rewarded or punished for such questions. Remember it. Yes, please. कोई भी और सवाल जो आपके दिमाग में आ रहा हो, feel free to ask, please. नहीं, बेहतर है कि एक एनसीईआरटी जरूर पढ़ लीजिए आप. Especially those topics which you are not going to touch in detail. Agar suppose kijiye ki aapko aisi topic nahi padhne ja rahe, let's say suppose aap agriculture ko detail mein nahi padhne ja rahe, to NCERT ka basics padh liya. Ya suppose kijiye ki jo climatology ka koi topic hai, you don't want to go through in detail. To ek brush up karna is better idea, especially in the initial period. Thoda moda revision, because agar, and that depends upon your ability to comprehend the way you have studied. And the last you have studied geography. When did you study geography the last? Like if you have studied, let's say not since last 1 year, then you need to brush the entire one. Obviously, but it will not be the case. Because any case, at least general studies you must have read before prelims. So that way you should decide about it. How much time you should give before result. No, that's what I'm told in the beginning, that there's nothing necessary. Even qualifying civil service is not necessary. Remember it. And I mean it. When I'm saying, I'm not joking it. I mean it, qualifying civil service is not necessary. Right, you can do away with without qualifying it. I may be having much better life than this. You may enter politics, become an MP, you have 4 IAS officers working under you. So nothing is necessary. Remember it, what actually you are trying to tell the examiner through your writing, that I have the capacity to use informations. I am using this map not because I know this map, not because I know how to draw this map, but because I feel very strongly that this is needed in this question. That's it. Time management is a very important aspect. 3 hours you have. In 3 hours you have to write almost 22 to... Learning, especially in Indian geography, you need to be more intensive. You must have gone through in prelims also. There are several techniques through which you can be applied. Like, for example, if you pick up some of the prominent points in different parts of the country. Let's say you have picked up the middle of the Siachen Glacier, Kanyakumari, and you have drawn a line. So that's one method, to draw a line through prominent places. But I strongly believe that the first thing you should do is that you should be perfectly aware of the state location, state boundary. That's easier to do. Right? You have all the state boundary very clear in your mind. Half of the work is done. More than half, I think, is the work is done. Because let's say Salem is asked. You know that northwestern, roughly northwestern Tamil Nadu or central western Tamil Nadu. That's more than enough. Because that map will not be this big. That map will be small. If you can draw Tamil Nadu there, so that's more than sufficient to draw Salem, unless until you have completely different locations in your mind. Like Annaimudi. So if you can locate Tamil Nadu and Kerala, you can easily draw Annaimudi. Now, something which is asked like something very uncommon, even if you have read it, if you have properly managed, you can't do it. be practical. That's it. Very often people get indulged so much into map making for 10 marks or 20 marks. Not advisable. Even if it is 60 marks, it's not advisable. Because two or the three questions will always be there, which you will have to find, decipher, and may need to contact so many books to actually reach there. That means you can't prepare. We have thousands or millions of such smaller cities, villages in our country, features in our country. So you can't prepare for that. Make all the prominent features. Remember one thing, that even in preliminary examination, and the same is mains examination, the question which can be answered by many, you should not commit a mistake in that. You will definitely be selected. Fundamental principle of prelims is the same. And the same in the larger context is about mains also. The questions which can be answered by most of the student, if you have committed mistakes and those questions stand, let's say, even 5%, you have lost the chance to qualify. If you have not committed any mistake, 99% chances that you will qualify. If you have not committed mistakes in that question, common thing. So always think about, let's say, suppose 8 out of 10 entries. 7 can be done by a good number of students. 8 can be done by specific students. That's it. So you should be the part of that specific students. That one should not be missed. That two must be missed, in fact. If that has not been missed, still you have less chance to qualify, remember it. Because you have given too much time into it. That's why you reach 10 out of 10. Or either you have been studying for a good long period of time, that's maybe then advantage. If you are first time writer and second time writer and you have done all the 10 entries, despite the fact that 8 is difficult to reach, that means you have given too much time into it. That means you have lost good quality time in other areas. So you will not be able to perform in other areas, remember it. नहीं, मैंने कभी नहीं बोला होगा ऐसा. नहीं, इसका इसका वही बता रहे हैं कि इसका इंडिविजुअल पे डिपेंड करता है. मैं बच्चों पे डिपेंड करता है कि मैं उसको क्या सजेस्ट करूं. जैसे कल ही मैं बता रहा हूं, मेरा एक स्टूडेंट है जो दो बार इंटरव्यू दे चुका है, बेचारा सिलेक्शन नहीं हुआ. हिज नेम इज मनिंदर. इफ यू सी हिज आंसर, इज सच राइट, सच अ लाइक बच्चों की तरह लिखता है वो. दिस ईयर ही कमिटेड अ मिस्टेक, अदरवाइज दिस ईयर ही वुड हैव क्रॉस्ड. ही मिस्ड बाय हार्डली 5-6 मार्क्स. एंड वो मिस्टेक क्या किया, वो पार्ट बी से दो उठा लिया. ना उसके स्टाइल ऑफ राइटिंग को पार्ट बी सूट नहीं करता है, ठीक है. इफ यू आर वेरी क्रिएटिव, दैट्स व्हाट द थिंग व्हाट आई बीन एम्फसाइजिंग अपॉन शुरू से, कि जो आपकी क्रिएटिविटी लेवल है वो अगर बहुत क्रिएटिव है, आप सेटलमेंट में भी, आप पर्सपेक्टिव इन ज्योग्राफी में भी क्रिएटिविटी दिखा सकते हैं, आप इंटीग्रेशन कर सकते हैं, तो आपके सेकेंड साइड ये है. आम जनरल सजेशन इसलिए पार्ट बी से पिक करना होता है कि पार्ट बी से बच्चे पिक कम करते हैं, और कोई वजह नहीं है. लिखने की अगर क्रिएटिविटी है आपके अंदर, तो हम प्लेट टेक्टोनिक को ऐसा लिख सकते हैं जो बेस्ट ऑफ द सिस्टम एनालिसिस वाला मार्क्स लग सकता है, उससे हम बेहतर प्लेट टेक्टोनिक्स में ला सकते हैं. बट द प्रॉब्लम इज दैट वेरी ऑफन वी हैव अ फीलिंग दैट प्लेट टेक्टोनिक द क्वेश्चन इज अ टॉपिक विच इज वेरी जनरल, विच वुड हैव बीन रिटन बाय एवरीवन. सो यू आर अफ्रेड ऑफ अटेम्प्टिंग दैट. You know that geography, climatology is mostly, students are good at these areas. So we prefer to jump into the second section and we prefer to choose questions from there. That's not a great idea. The selection should be based first on your ability and second on that particular day of examination, that whether you can do justice with this question better than that. Again, preconceived notion is not a basic trait of an administrator. In any case, you will be reading part 2 also. At least 2-3 topics are compulsory. Let's say models and theories, perspective in human geography, and population and settlement. If these 3 has been done, you will automatically get the minimum required question. And if you get 2 questions, you have an advantage. Now, when you are writing population, let's say suppose question in settlement is slightly twisted in such a manner that you miss out, if you write, you will miss out major content. Should you attempt that? Rather than attempting something, let's say climatic classification, which you have content, you know that it's a dry topic, yet you can score higher in this. So never have a preconceived notion. Every area is equally scoring, provided you know how to be creative. Let's say suppose soils. driest topic supposed to be? In geography, remembering that, the characteristics and all. Now see, there's two lines and every characteristics of soil can be remembered. If you write on that perspective, you're not being bookish. Let's say suppose distribution of soil is totally a reflection of parent material, largely a reflection of parent material, red soil. What is there in the red soil? Why it is red? Iron oxides. Iron is what? A heavy metallic mineral. So in the area where you have heavy metallic minerals, you have greater chances for formation of red soils. So can we say that all the older plateaus of the world will be containing red soils? As simple as that. Right. Now, if you see the texture and the structure, soil texture is primarily determined by the three major constituents, sand, silt and clay. You have sandy soil, you have silty soil, you have clayey soil. When you are asked, present a classification of world soil, you start with Marbut, you start with Dokachev, you start with the zonal American classification. You don't write about silty, sandy and clay. That's the problem. They didn't tell you to write specifically that what American classification, write down the American classification. Even if it is specifically mentioned, start with that. Because that is the primary natural way to classify soil. When you say sandy, silty, clay. Now sandy, silty and clay, if you move on, the particle space decreases or increases? Pore space? Sandy mein zyada hoga, clay mein kam hoga. Sandy mein jab zyada hoga, iski water holding capacity kya ho jayegi? Nutrient holding capacity kya ho jayegi? Blowability kaisi, workability kaisi ho jayegi? Easy working ho jayegi. Agriculture ke liye bahut suitable kyun nahi hoga? Water holding, nutrient holding capacity. Ab socho sari characteristic yahi likhoge jab kisi soil mein likhoge. Clay mein kya hai? Water holding capacity zyada hai. Right? Nutrient holding capacity zyada hai. So even in a semi-arid areas, like Vidarbha region of our country, you can grow sugarcane. Why? Because it's a clay soil. We call it black cotton soil. A clay soil has better water holding capacity, so even a small amount of rainfall can provide sufficient amount of moisture to the plants. That's it. Now, in an area which is having heavy rainfall, clay soil is suitable or not? No. Because water logging will be very quickly, and it might submerge the crops and all. Can you write? You don't need to read books. Simple basic correlation of the basic properties. Discuss the classify the world soils and discuss the basic characteristics of each. What will be the characteristics? These are the characteristics. Humus hoga ke nahi? Aeration hoga ke nahi? The soil which has larger pore space will have more air. So uske andar aeration kya ho jayega? Zyada ho jayega. Humus is more about fossils. So if the biotic community is there and soil has enough amount of time, at least that much reading we will definitely make even from NCRT. Yeah, what are the different factors which affect the soil formation? You can bring that and you can correlate and make it dynamic. When the examiner reads, he or she knows that this guy is not a general lot who has written from somewhere else. It is he who has created something. He says, actually have gone into the topic. Going in the topic doesn't mean that content should be more. Going to this topic means concept should be deeper. And look at everything can be correlated with the concept. You pick up anything. Very often a common question is asked in preliminary examination. Four cities of our country will be given, or for that matter world cities will be given, and you have to arrange that cities on the basis of a height above mean sea level. And I have seen students struggling to find the answer that should I remember the height of all the cities. That's not the job of an IAS officer, remember it. And UPSC will never ask you those questions. Height of cities are determined primarily by looking at how will you find, let's say suppose how won't you find Allahabad is higher or Kanpur is higher. River flows. River always flow from greater height to lower height. So there is fundamental concept. That's why geography not only be interesting, it will not be a burden, but it will be very easy to prepare. Very often you have complaints about the geography syllabus is very lengthy. It's not at all lengthy. It becomes lengthy. You make it lengthy because you study individual topics separately. Look at the whole five topics. Earth interior, volcanism, earthquake, continental drift theory, seafloor spreading, and plate tectonic theory. These six topics is so integrated that this is just basically one topic. Is nothing but plate tectonic. All these topics is basically plate tectonic. Even the interior of the earth is plate tectonic. Volcanism is plate tectonic. Like plate tectonics, if you read plate tectonic, you understand all the topics. Now, when you write any of these topics, can you bring all the five topics, six topics in the introductory line itself? Or the gist of all that? Can you bring that? That's the challenge. Anything else? I hope you all must be knowing we are going to have a test on 18th and we'll have discussion of that on 30th, and thereafter we'll have the test discussion simultaneously every fortnight at 9:30 a.m. and you can take the time also. The only thing required there is, again, at least in your first 2-3 answers, be as creative as possible. Even be ready to commit mistakes so that we together can dig it out. Don't follow the traditions. Don't follow the way you have writing. Those who have already written earlier also, don't follow that. Just jump the gun directly. Attitude should be left behind. And start with a fresh. Come with a fresh mind. 18th is the first test. All those who are interested can join it. Any more question, I hope? We can wind up. Thank you and take care.